Good morning to you all. This is amazing. This is officially the biggest audience I've ever spoken in front of. So I'm going to take a little picture with you first, just to remember this. I probably need a panorama view, so I'm going to take a few. Thank you so much for being here. This is a beautiful start already. I'm going to get started right away. This is the relationship chart of one of my favorite series. It's not Breaking Bad, it's Game of Thrones, and it's a new season coming soon. Yeah, super excited. What I love about this is how complicated and intricate this web of relationships is. And I'm in awe of George R.R. Martin for simply thinking through each and every relationship script with such intricacy, and how suddenly each relationship changes brutally into something different. I've been in a relationship of my own for the last 9 years with my Khaleesi. We recently have had a new dragon, so we've taken the relationship up a new level. But I'm not the only one here who is unique to relationships. Each of you here is, or has been, or has experience in relationships. You're either dating someone right now, or engaged, or you're probably married, or even in the worst case scenario, if you aren't in a relationship, you've seen movies, you've read books, you have friends who are in relationships, and I want us for the next 30 minutes to use the experiences we've had from these relationships. We've heard stories of breakups over dinner, or about the proposal, how you planned for those months and months to go drop down on your knees and ask that question to the one that you love. Or, where I come from in India, the Bollywood scripts, which are super predictable and cheesy and romantic. Now, I want to caveat here, right off the start, I'm not here to advocate or tell you that we should all love Bollywood and watch Bollywood films or Hollywood mainstream cinema in our evenings. But what I do believe is that these movies have a formula in them, a formula that has repeated itself over years and years, over centuries, and is relevant in all our geographies, no matter where we come from. For the next half an hour, I want us to focus on what is our formula for getting our users to form relationships with us. What is our predictable, cheesy at times, mostly functional, delightful, useful relationship formula that gets our customers or our users to form long-lasting relationships with us? Because that's what we're here about. I'm Rahul. I tweet at RahulSen79 and occasionally at Spotify Design, and I encourage you to continue this dialogue with me after we've left. I call this formula relationship sauce, and it is something that I've been using for the last many years now. Relationship sauce is something that has caused some of the best products that we use today to exist in our lives, in our pockets, in our homes. And it's also something that dates all the way back to when the Taj Mahal was built in the 1600s. Let's start by reading out a definition of what I believe relationship sauce really is. It is the key ingredient in a product that enables it to be great at forming lasting relationships with users. Think of your product as Ryan Gosling in Crazy Stupid Love, right? The moment you walk into the bar in that movie, you see Ryan Gosling right there, and you go, wow, who is that guy? I want to know that person, right? Your product has that same ability inside of it. It has different abilities. Not all your products are exactly like Ryan Gosling, but they're always trying to get your user to fall in love, stay in love with them. And during this process of crafting your own unique relationship sauce, it's very important, as my speakers before and after me will tell you, to focus on the science of data. This is a rational part of the world. We all believe in data. But I want us to become informed by the art of dating. This is a soft skill. This is something that we've all experienced outside of our work life, but somehow struggle to bring it into our own lives, into our own work when we go to our offices. I want us to think of our product as having a conversation, a date, a meaningful series of dates with our users, trying to get them to sort of call us back for that second call, call us back for that anniversary, years after being together. Oops. I've had a sort of varied background over the last decade or so. I started out in theater Did about 5-10 years of theater and overlapped the last 5 of those with architecture. And over the years, I moved to Sweden to start a career in design, which I now practice at Spotify. This is my design team. It comprises of lead designers, of researchers, of data scientists. But all through this journey, I've always had one common red thread. And this is the red thread of relationships. Just gonna let my slides catch up for a second. Yep. More than the relationships itself, I want to understand what are the narrative hooks that you put in the stories of these relationships. The stories like the Red Wedding, if you remember Game of Thrones, that just hook you in your heart and make you remember it forever and ever. What is it about the Taj Mahal that stands out in the world as a symbol of love? Is it just that it's beautiful and symmetrical and made of marble? Or is it something deeper? Is there a story coded in the Taj Mahal that makes it a wonder of the world? What is it about this lamp that many of us might have seen or even have in our homes that makes it such an iconic lamp? Is it just the fact that it's very difficult to make, it's got intricate engineering, or does it play on our memories of nature and thereby become a lasting, sticky relationship that we can always look at and relate to? Or what about this chair by Philip Stark that actually plays on the memories we have of 3 master chairs and superimposes these together to form a new chair? Products have always had scripts embedded in them for centuries. This is not new. But the kind of stories that these products are telling us has changed or is changing. As we become more and more digital, these product stories are changing. Take, for example, the time when I was working at Veriday and working on a medical ventilator. When we worked on this ventilator for McKay, a client here in Stockholm, their predecessor was one of the market leaders in ventilation, and it was all about visualizing oxygen, carbon dioxide, and it was very serious stuff. But in the new iteration that we made a few years ago, and it launched just recently, we were able to play in a space where we were able to visualize the breath and the recovery of a patient in an emotional manner so that it would make people in the ICU, stressed out family members, stressed out nurses, smile a bit and look at the process of recovery as an emotional story rather than just a pure scientific one. Or take the example of the projects we did when I was at Nike in New York working at RGA, where our whole effort and all our conversations were always centered around getting our users to form a healthy habit loop. Many of us are probably wearing these kinds of wearables on our wrists already. This is not just about tracking how many steps you took or how much you sat or how much you moved a day. It's about getting you to constantly be in a relationship with the brand, with the product, but most importantly, be in a relationship with the positive motivation that these products bring us. And lastly, and presently, where I am currently working at Spotify, I'm sure all of you here are very familiar with this relationship where you reach for your phones every morning, especially on Mondays, and start looking out for your Discover Weekly playlist because we want you to get into a relationship with us for different times and different moments in our day. The fundamental difference between the products I showed you before and the ones that we are now in the process of making is that only digital products can unfold their stories over time and over space. And the most important unique factor is that only digital products have the innate ability in themselves to propagate their own adoption and thereby grow themselves. Take, for example, Airbnb, which I think Alexander mentioned in his keynote this morning. Airbnb and other digital services like itself can reward you for bringing your friends to that service by actually paying you money. Now, as much as I love this chair for being iconic, it cannot do that because it's static and it's just there and it's going to get older over time. Airbnb can renew itself as it grows and as its customer base grows. Take, for example, another great successful company like Dropbox, who reward its users with extra storage space if you bring more people to that service. As much as we like it, our buildings are not going to expand their storage space in the current forms that they are in. Take, for example, Spotify, and I mentioned Discover Weekly here. There's a very conscious thought that has been put into this feature to try and make users pull out their phone every morning and say, I wonder what Spotify has in store for me this morning. And we're not the only service that's doing this. There's many other successful ones that are trying to get you to whip out your phone every morning and check through your notifications and say, hey, who's posted? How many likes have I had? And these are all cues that they're putting in your mind to get you to form a relationship with them. I think by now it's pretty obvious that I'm saying that every relationship has a script. And just as you are all unique, your relationship script is unique as well. Let's take an example of a very typical relationship script. You usually start by asking the person you want to go out with to go out on a coffee or a fika in this part of the world, right? You just want to go out, have a fika, get to know each other. Are you compatible? Do you have the same topics of interest? Are you even like pleasant to look at for each other, right? After a while, when you've made it a habit of getting back on dates, and this is huge success. If you cross the first date, that's amazing, because now you can start to make more grandiose gestures. You can say, hey, nice to see you again. I brought you some flowers, or here are some tickets to the cinema. Let's go have some fun. And thereafter, and this is elastic time, of course, not all of this happens in the same spectrum of time, but after a while, you want to say something more bold and daring, like, I love you. Or, do you want to move in together? Do you want to try getting engaged? At some point, you want to get down on your knees and say, hey, I love you. Do you want to marry me? And after that, so many of us have spent hours and hours, in my case, it was a year planning our wedding and figuring out every single detail it would take to make that wedding memorable, not only for my wife and myself, but also for all the people who attended. And currently, we're in the process of staying married, which I'm sure a lot of you will relate to, which is the long, arduous road ahead, which is about making that relationship continue to be fun and meaningful and exciting and valuable to you, no matter what your relationship definition is. The unlikely script, however, and this is where a lot of companies get it wrong, is that you start by proposing marriage to the user straight away, and then after that you say, do you want to have a cup of coffee? And the users are like, huh? You don't even know me yet, and you're already asking me to commit to you. This is impossible. I'm not interested. Move on. So each relationship script is unique, but archetypes exist. And these archetypes repeat themselves over time, over cultures, over space, as patterns. And these are patterns that we can relate to, and we can immediately look and go, ah, that's a rom-com, or, oh, that's a horror movie, and this is going to end well, this is going to end badly, right? You start to understand how it's going, and it makes you feel comfortable. We use patterns as well. I'm a designer. And in my profession, we use patterns like UX patterns. And there are lots and lots of websites talking about grids and screens and layouts and buttons. In the world of architecture as well, we have patterns. There's walls, there's doors, there's stairs, things that you can look at and immediately relate to. But a good relationship script is not formed by stringing together random sets of screens and patterns, right? It's about infusing those patterns with the right recipe for falling in love. Why is this important, you might ask? This is a search in the App Store for productivity tools. And as you can see already, they all start to look and feel the same. They've all got a checkbox, because everyone relates to that pattern. But imagine opening every app and finding the same features, the same stuff in each of them. This is the overcrowded marketplace that we are all playing in. No matter who we are or what company we're coming from, it's quite likely that if you have a great idea or a great product, it's already been done by someone out there, so you need to be different. You need to stand out as not the rest of the people. Sounds familiar, right? This is very similar to the scenario we have of speed dating, where you don't have time to make much of an impact or an impression, but you need to make a sticky, lasting one with the little time and the little chances that you get. We live in a Tinderized society in our products, in the way that we pull out our phone, download products after each other, and we try and look at it for a second and go, is this interesting? No. And if it's not interesting, you're going to keep swiping. You're going to swipe away. You're going to say, I'm not interested in this. It didn't stick in my life. And the ones that remain in your memory and the ones that fulfill the need that you have or the desire or the functions that you have with your life are the ones that have the right recipe for relationship sauce in them. So my lasting thesis for you this morning is that you need to design your product's relationship because that's what's going to help your product grow its user base and form long-lasting relationships with its customers and users. For those of you in the audience who are from a product or a marketing background, this growth funnel is pretty familiar to you. You're talking about marketing as reach and teach, and then you're talking about acquisition of users and activating them into the funnel, and over time converting them and then retaining them as loyal users, right? But when I start sketching a user journey, no matter where we are or which product I'm working on, one of the habits I try to imbibe is using the relationship metaphor to almost rethink that funnel and that user journey as a dating relationship with the intent of taking users from the first date all the way to your 5th or 10th and wedding anniversary, right? So when you talk about your sign-up moment, try ask yourselves, how do you rethink that sign-up moment to become a great first date? When you think about asking people who've been kind of frequently using an app which is free, and you want to try and pop a modal or pop something that says, hey, do you want to pull out your credit card and pay us some money? Ask yourselves, have you prepared it in the right form to make it a relevant proposal to the user? Or is it going to be like that wedding proposal where you just barely got to know the user and you're already asking them to commit to marriage? And they're like, huh? You don't know me yet. Products have personalities. We are all here because we work in whatever world we work in to endow these products with the right personalities. We try and create quirks in them. We try and create function and features. And over time, these products become people. They stand for something, right? No matter how good a person you are, if you don't have the ability to reach out and interact and lure your users in and keep them in there, you're just another product in that huge graveyard of products that no one's going to care about and no one's going to use in a lasting way. Our products have Tinder profiles too. Go back to work and look at your own websites and ask yourselves, have you thought of your websites as Tinder profiles? And ask yourselves, if the user has 30 seconds and I need to make a lasting impression, am I saying the right things? Am I using the right imagery to make the lasting impressions that I need? Am I making them feel my value through the content that I am publishing on my website? Every time a user is going back to your product on a Monday evening or a Saturday night for a party, they're trying to go back there and make a useful date out of it. And it's important that you always continue this dialogue with your customers and users to make them remember how exciting and memorable each date is. This doesn't need to be cheesy. It doesn't need to be dreary and overtly romantic. It needs to reinforce whatever values it is that your product stands for, whether it's function or utility or just delight. And yes, very often there are breakups happening on our service. People are not happy. They're saying, hey, I want out of this relationship. And they're calling up our customer service and saying, I'm going to break up with Spotify. I'm going to break up with whatever product it is that you're making. And in these moments as well, if you're applying the relationship sauce analogy, you start to think of it as a good breakup, right? You can always leverage all the data, all the insights that you have about your users to say, all right, if you have to go, go. It's fine. But go with a little bit of music. Go with a song in your heart, right? And you can still watch your user walk away and say, hey, kid, at least they're walking away with a positive feeling versus going through like hundreds and hundreds of screens and leaving with a really like ugly taste in their mouth, saying, this was a horrible breakup. I'm never, ever going to advocate this service ever again. And most importantly, I think all of us are here because we want our products to make deep, lasting relationships with our user. And for those of you who've been on Spotify for a while, you probably don't remember, but there was a time when you were shown this model and you were asked to pull out your credit card to commit to something long term. How have you thought of your experience when you're asking users to pay? How are you building trust? How are you reinforcing all the values that it is that you and your product stand for in that moment of proposal? So that users don't hesitate and go, not sure, I'm not convinced yet. Because if they are doing that, then it's the wrong time to propose, or you're not proposing well. And I think this is something that all of us relate to when we are in December or January, and whether we are on Facebook or Instagram or even in Spotify, and we try to celebrate anniversaries with our users, where we bring them back to our service and say, hey, look at the last year and how awesome it's been. Come back, enjoy, reminisce, sit back with a glass of champagne and smile that you've discovered new forms of hip hop or new genres that you never even know existed, so that you feel like you want to continue investing in this relationship. So if all of us agree that relationships are the vital ingredient that we need to imbibe in our product, it's also very important to know your relationship, because not all relationships are the same. And I have kind of classified just four, but there's many more that you could go back and brainstorm with your own teams and groups. You have the new romance, there's relationships like the fatal attraction, there's the arranged marriage. I'm Indian, I have to talk about arranged marriage. But there's also one-night stands, and that's fine. Not every product needs to get into a lasting relationship and have long anniversaries with users. Understand what your product is about and apply the appropriate relationship script to it so that it's bang on in terms of its recipe. Let's talk about two of these in a little more detail. The new romance. I mean, if you all seen movies like Amélie by Jean-Pierre Jeunet, you'll know this is a classic relatable script that all of us smile at when we go to a rom-com movie, right? It's boy meets girl, they fall in love, they get to know each other well, over time something dramatic happens, they overcome that, and then they go, I mean, after overcoming that, they drive off into the sunset, or here, in this case, MoMA, on a scooter, and everyone's happy, everyone lives happily ever after. New romances are very important as relationship recipes in markets and in places where people don't know who you are. It's the first time that you've entered a new space. For example, when Pinterest came out, nobody knew what the heck they were about. It was a service that made it a glorified bulletin board, and people were like, why do I need this? I have my cork board in my office. Why would Pinterest be of any use here, right? It's one of the most successful, highly funded startups in the Valley right now, and they've done that by generating a great relationship script out of their onboarding series and making their users understand through that onboarding series why they are a useful service, how you can use them. Their relationship script talks about moments in your life, like focus on making a Pinterest board for your wedding, or planning to buy a new car, here, make a Pinterest board for it. And in doing that, they make the date memorable, not by pointing at UI and saying, hey, this is a button, click here, that is a screen, click there, but by saying, this is how I am of use to you and why you should come back to me every day. If you care about me, come back to me every day and use me for whatever it is that you're trying to do in your life. And thereby, the user base that Pinterest has generated has been caused by a successful onboarding experience. So even in this, the analogy of dating and the rules of standard dating apply. And I haven't been in a dating situation for a long time myself. It's been 9 years. But I talk to friends all the time, and I have a lot of coaching sessions with them where they talk about, what do I do? How do I go about this date that I'm going out for? And I'd love to talk about it with you after this event. I'm sure you all have unique stories of how you tackle that first date, because it's so important. So it's important that in their first date as a product, you make it a very, very memorable one. Because as I said, there's a huge marketplace, there's a lot of crowd, there's a lot of people calling up saying, hey, date me, and you're like, oh, not interested, swipe. So when they actually are there for that first date, you need to make it memorable. And here, it's important to remember that you're not trying to make it gimmicky, you're not trying to make it cheesy just for the sake of being cheesy and make sort of grandiose gestures just so that they think that you want them to fall in love, but you have to make it memorable through function, through meaning, and through the actual core of what your service is really about. By date two, and this is where many products haven't even succeeded in date one, people have just downloaded the app, seen something, and they've just said, I'm not interested, not calling you back a second time. If your user is coming back for the second date, it's very important to get users to form the aha with them. And what I mean by the aha is that by now, if you have a personality in your product, you stand for something, it's important to let your users know by the second date that this is who you are, this is why you stand for something different, and why your users need to come back every day. And this doesn't need to be a modal, it needs to be through content or through the features that you have. And lastly, and here's where it gets a bit cheeky, is by date three, if you've made all the right impressions, it's okay to lean in for the kiss. Don't lean in on date one, because you're going to get pushed back. Lean in by date three. It's OK. Make your intentions known. And if the user isn't ready to commit, the user needs some more time, at least they'll know that you want to make a commitment, and that's fine. Wait, I'm not ready yet. A lot of mistakes that services and products make is they lean in for the first day for the kiss, and then they go, psh, go away. This is creepy. You're spamming me. Stop. Let's talk about an affair for a second. And this is very controversial because you're like, huh, are we having affairs with our users now? Yes, we are. Yes, we are, because most of our users are already in a relationship with someone else. In an economy like Sweden, where it's very, very digitally savvy, you already have competitors for almost every product that it is that you're working on. And so when you are thinking about your relationship script, you cannot approach it as a new romance. You need to apply the principles of having an affair. And what I mean by that, let's talk about Elo for a second. How many of you have heard of Elo here? A few. That's great. So Elo was positioned as a social network a few years ago, which was supposed to be the anti-Facebook. Can you believe that? Someone would dare, in today's times, take on Facebook. They began with a very, very strong and bold manifesto, where they talked about how a user's data was being given away to our advertisers with every click, with every link, and every share that we did. When you go to a Facebook landing page, it's very straightforward, very to the point. They don't need anything, really, because they already have such a strong customer base. So they just say, sign up already and get in the community. But when you see Elo's landing page, their first value proposition is smacking of an affair. It says, beautiful and ad-free. And in doing that, they're saying, we are not that. We are not Facebook. We're beautiful and we're ad-free. And when you scroll further down, they try to tell you that, hey, we are not. You're not going to be alone here. There's a lot of people already who are enjoying Elo. And lastly, and this is really bold, I thought, they put that manifesto not in some kind of terms and conditions at the back of some legal document. They put that right on the home page and said, this is who we stand for. This is our manifesto and why we exist. And what I loved about this, and a little bit of an affair thinking, was if you clicked I agree, it opens up a little share screen that says, oh, you agree? Share this with your friends. Bring them on. Let them also agree or disagree. Let's have more of your friends. And more interestingly, if you say, I disagree, it pushes you to Facebook's terms and conditions. It says, all right, don't agree with us. Go check out how your data is being given away for free by someone else who you've given all your life away to. And I thought that was a very bold move that was saying, if you believe in taking on Goliath, you need to have an affair. And what I also like about Elo's feed is when you actually see the content, they give you the content pretty much for free. Most of the content that is being published is very inspirational. It's very sort of high, a lot of designers and artists and craftspeople posting their stuff there. And they show you the content for free. But they always keep a little exposed input box that says, if you're interested, if you're excited, commit to the relationship, sign up for an account right now. And this is a standard trick that a lot of us are using, but it's smacking of that affair where it's saying, you can always fall in love with someone later if you give people the chance to fall in love. But many of us forget that that simple input box can make such a difference when users are actually testing out your product in that first date or that first affair. Let's look at some numbers, just because we're a rational society here. And we see activity breakdowns for Elo is 36% users who never posted. 27% who posted more than three times, and it had a 20% plus second week retention. So what does that mean? Let's compare Elo's success with what we know and understand. This is how Elo fared compared to Twitter. They were fairly at par in terms of their first week retention. In terms of user acquisition, while Instagram was acquiring users at a faster rate just simply by being present in more countries, Elo's second week acquisition percentage was actually higher than Instagram, which is insane given that Instagram is one of the most successful viral services that we have out there. So in your Facebook, Relationship Sauce works. There is a script here that we all can relate to and we should start using in the design of our products. And lastly, I won't go on too much about this, but there are scripts like the One Night Stand, and this is fine. If you ask yourself how many times you've used that one zombie app or that one face swap app that you just used a couple of times, laughed and giggled and then deleted from your phone, those are all great one-night stands to have with the product. You don't need to keep sending people emails to sort of make those sort of lasting relationships there. It's fun for that one time that you had it. And focus on that one time, make it very desirable and delightful, and get your growth from there. And lastly, arranged marriage is something that I call every situation where you've bought a phone or a tablet bundled with some kinds of services. And you didn't choose all this. Like when you buy a phone, you already have pre-installed apps, right? That's arranged marriage. Your user didn't consciously go to the app store and download anything. They said, ah, this is a new phone. What is this stuff? What is this app? And in that moment, you need to position your app differently from the new romance or from the affair. You need to tell people, all right, you already have a phone, you're already married to us, but let's try and get you to love us over time. You're not going anywhere, but let's still try and take you over for the long journey ahead. I'd like to end with a story about the Taj Mahal and how it infuses relationship sauce unknowingly in 1600s. When you read a little bit about the Taj Mahal, you realize that it was built in memory of the Empress Mumtaz Mahal, who died when she was very young. Now, the Emperor Shah Jahan was so besotted when he lost his beautiful wife that he wanted to create a building that would remind centuries to come of what it was like to be in her presence. Now, if you read history books about the Taj Mahal and the Mughals, you'll know that Mumtaz Mahal was a very frail, a lightly built person. And so when you saw her from far, you thought she was really short and very pale. But when you got to know her up close and personally, she amazed people with her wit, with the knowledge that she had of the arts and the crafts. And this is the emotional feeling, the hook, that Emperor Shah Jahan wanted all of you to have, even now when you visit the Taj. Here's how it happens. When you first walk in, after negotiating through lots and lots of traffic and noise, you see this dark frame, and it actually just focuses your mind to seeing just the Taj. And it looks almost small, because you've seen photographs before, you know it's kind of big. But when you first see the Taj, it looks kind of small and petite, and you're almost like, whoa, that's really small. But every step you take towards the Taj Mahal, it starts to reveal more of itself to you. You start noticing all the patterns, you start noticing the symmetry even more, and you start noticing that there's a perfect triangular proportion between the tips of the spires that is all super harmonious, and it makes you feel delighted every step you take closer and closer to the inner sanctum. This was an emperor with no technology who just sat and figured out some graphs on sand or stone or whatever the tools we had in that time were, and actually captured the love he had for his wife in marble. And we still go there every day, and we feel wowed by it. So I urge you, when you go back to work and start testing whatever it is that you're testing, A/B, and you're trying to understand what's going to make your users stick, infuse relationship sauce at the strategy level, right at the start. And during this process, data has to inform us. We are still rational, we love data, but we want to use our dating experiences to enrich that experience, to make that a delightful journey. So I'd like to end by saying, get your users to love, need, be delighted by your product. Start by designing a relationship sauce now. Thank you.